Durante tiempos de Guerra Fría,
for during the Cold War world, Russia and India had a very strong relationship in the military, economic, and diplomatic. When USSR fell, Russia had the representation, but also the very strong relationship with India. So there's a long relationship that has been built on five components: defense, economy, civil, cooperation, and foreign space. And they have the same representation in many organisms, and this makes it even stronger. Russia and India, a partnership that may be going against the U.S. This is what we're going to be analyzing today. We'll be having more information, and as always, your critical thinking. Let's begin. Let's see, ever since September 4th, in the city of Vladivostok in Russia, there's the fifth economic summit with the participation of many countries, 8,000 participants in all, of over 60 countries, and at least 30 agreements have been signed. This has been instituted on May 30th by the President Putin. It's held every year. This is in Vladivostok, and there's an emphasis up until now with the fundamental principles in opening new horizons and possibilities for development in the far eastern part of Russia. Therefore, Russia and India have far had a long relationship in this sense. I would like to highlight that India is one of our partners, one of the best partners, and our relationship is of strategic nature and privileged. We have been developing continuously based on the mutual interest and friendship. On the side of Russia and India, we hold our priority in the cooperation. Bilateral interests have increased, and it's $11,000. We think that there's all the conditions to keep growing. During this political trip, President Trump and I has had the cooperation and friendship has also grown. And our relationship has also helped the strategic interests of our people, that our people receive benefits. Both countries understand that nowadays, to gain stability and peace, we need a multipolar world. Our cooperation and coordination will be important to gain it. This is the reason why BRICS and the Shanghai Cooperation Summit must strengthen. Well, these are words that open the door to what we're going to be talking. Let's see digital sites. Let's go to Xinhua.net. And they published today, Putin and the Far East of Russia will cooperate Asia-Pacific. And here we have the picture of the leaders of the five countries that participated today. And the host, which is Russia, we have Vladimir Putin in the center. Let's show it to our people. The first minister of India, of Mongolia, there his president was, Malaysia, and the Prime Minister of Japan, Shinzo Abe. That is right, the first one in the picture. And in the details, we see that the cooperation in the Asia-Pacific is a key element for President Putin. He said with investment and improving the investment, Russia has been able to develop the Far East of Russia. And this means that there's been an increase of 23%. And there has been ports and areas of strengthened commerce.
También se están creando empleos.
There's also been job creation. And he also said that
es una atmósfera de
this is an
de
atmosphere of cooperation and trust
de Asia Pacífico en general,
in the Asia
decir,
of,
lo que hemos logrado
of Russia and Pacific.
De atmósfera de confianza, decía, aclaró el presidente anfitrión.
This is what the host president said.
Sputnik,
let's go to Sputnik, who published
ayer,
yesterday, September 5th.
Putin,
the leadership of West is coming to an end.
Le cito, creo que para
I quote, I think that for everybody it's clear now, and Macron also said so, the leadership of the West is coming to an end. I can't imagine that an international organization could be efficient without the participation of India and China. Close quote. And he also said, he spoke of the how many participation in this summit. They were 8,500. In all of his speech, he spoke of the Far East because this was one of the objectives that has opened year to year ever since 2015.
In Span TV,
we have that India does not go with the anti-Iranian coalition of the U.S. And once they've done it in the Persian Gulf, the U.S., India has been clear that they will not add to this anti-Iranian campaign because they have had their own brushes with the Iranian government. That means that their ships will be there, but they will not attack. I repeat, this is what an authority of India has said. He was quoted by Reuters. This is of 2019, just a couple of months ago. Now I'm going back to Sputnik. This is today, September 6th. It says that the priority of the Pentagon. He makes an analysis saying that not only India has declared their neutrality in the position of the U.S. confronting Russia and China, but also with the Prime Minister of Japan in the Economic Forum of Blastovic.
De la agenda de construcción del orden liberal estadounidense.
This means that he has no longer all of the support of India.
Después de la notable intervención del primer ministro
after the intervention of India in this economic forum,
coloca a India
this makes India like a neutral country in the region.
Se derrumba la estrategia excluyente de la anglófera encabezada por Estados
this
Unidos,
means that India no longer counts with their support. And this is not only India's position. It's also been the presence of Japan also made a statement. It's susceptible to take one piece away also from having a group of Washington.
Mientras dos aliados notables de Estados Unidos
well, the allies of
Tokyo libran una intensa lucha comercial.
Well, the allies of the West of the Washington
esto,
are now having commerce among themselves because this speaks
de cómo estaría la correlación de fuerzas.
Of how the co-relationship of forces is.
Lo que estamos recomendando, Alfredo Jalife Rahme, experto en geopolítica.
This is written by Alfredo Jalife Rahme, an international analyst.
Let's go now ¿cuál es to el status de la relación India-Rusia?
To ask ourselves, what is the status of India and Russia? It's important to see the strategic aspects on which this relationship is based on. And if this has anything to do with the United States. And here we have some ideas that Alfredo Jalife said, and then we will analyze it with our guests after this pause. Thank you.
Rusia-India, binomio llave que reta a Estados Unidos y plantea un nuevo orden. Nos preguntamos hoy en nuestra jugada crítica. Y bueno, para comenzar este segmento es importante
to start this new segment, I think it's important to start to solve this question that we posed before. And from here, our investigation system, we investigated a little bit of the of how this relationship goes on.
India y Rusia profundizan sus vínculos cada vez más.
Han avanzado en acuerdos en materia energética de defensa, económica y espacial.
En lo que respecta a energía, ambos países sostuvieron conversaciones para proyectos conjuntos de gas en el Ártico. Entre el 11 y el 13 de agosto, un grupo de funcionarios indios visitó la ciudad rusa de Vladivostok. Allí, el ministro de Comercio e Industria, Piyush Goyal, señaló que su país está interesado en que Rusia juegue un mayor rol
has a larger role in the energy department of his country, and he says that they're willing to work together in exploration in the Arctic.
Otro rubro clave del Another relacionamiento es defensa. India tiene un sistema de defensa ruso S-400, es el país que compró mayor cantidad de material bélico ruso durante 2018
después de China y Turquía. Adquirió cinco complejos
S-400 por $5 billion
They bought $5 billion de armas de fabricación and they operate rusa, many weapons
de batalla como el of Russian production. Hasta aviones militares como los cazas MiG-29 o Su-30 MKI. También en materia espacial,
also
Rusia
in
e
space
India
aspects,
avanzando. India está
India
interesada en incorporarse a la carrera espacial, planea crearse su propia estación en 2030 y se espera que un astronauta indio llegue al espacio en la misión Gagarin en 2022. Para ello, Moscú suministrará su experiencia, además de trajes espaciales y sistemas de soporte vital para una nave tripulada.
Having, all of the systems
en lo comercial,
in place.
El ministro de Exteriores ruso, Sergei Lavrov, anunció
Sergei Lavrov, the Minister of Commerce of Russia, say that they will start as soon as possible and they will try to establish a free trade zone with India and Euro-Asia. This will include India and former Russia nations.
En la actualidad, el comercio bilateral entre ambas naciones supera los 11 millones de dólares. Sin embargo, la meta es alcanzar los 30 millones de dólares en inversiones mutuas en agricultura, industrias y economía digital.
And digital technology.
Bueno, hay un punto particular point where we would like to go a bit deeper.
And this is that India doesn't care about the threats of the U.S. And they try to keep their alliance with Russia.
Más del 70% de las armas y equipo bélico de los componentes.
Allí datos importantes. India el principal cliente de los
India
armeros rusos,
the main
más del 70% de las armas y los
Russia,
equipos que caracterizan o con los cuales operan sus componentes militares diversos, digo, son de fabricación
Russian
producción rusa y soviética. Y hay un importante encargo que se dio formalmente en octubre pasado, según informaron los medios, de India a Rusia,
India
de regimiento de misiles antiaéreos
anti-missile
$400 million con una entrega prevista para
that will be delivered in a couple of months, and they paid $5 billion for this. And there's a defense system that can intercept and destroy up to six objectives at a time. All of this has created some hardships for the U.S. because they have threatened India if they keep on buying weapons from Russia. And there are some countries who don't care about the threats, and the U.S. has even placed some sanctions. Let's speak some important points on this.
Para tener ese puntito allí para profundizar. Vamos a sumar desde Venezuela a Miguel Jaimes, doctor en ciencias gerenciales, magíster en ciencias políticas.
He's a magister in political science and geopolitics.
Diplomado en geopolítica del petróleo y de la web de este diplomado.
He works for a very important university. From Barcelona, we have Pedro Ortega. He's an investigator of the Barcelona University. It's a pleasure to have you with us. Miguel, can I start with you?
There's a first aspect that
this relationship of Russia and India. And what is their strength?
What are these por strengths Estados Unidos, sino para qué merodea tanto con sus embarcaciones militares en el Pacífico.
Pudiésemos comenzar
el
proyecto Chindir
y
India.
China and India. It's a development in the military area, the largest one in the world.
Reúne a más de 24 millones de efectivos y más unos 24 million más people. En reserva.
And they have lots more in reserve.
And they have a huge potential. China es casi el primer exportador de armas a nivel mundial.
Let's not forget that China
is even an exporter of weapons.
And then we have another area that is chemicals, communication,
participando en las technology, emergentes.
They both participate in the emergent economies,
and these are,
and this doesn't make the U.S. so happy, obviously.
China tiene 9 millones de kilómetros cuadrados de territorio,
9 million square kilometers, and 60%
of its surface
is cultivated. They want to have to boost their consumption of 13 and 14 barrels a day.
So if we gathered the thesis of Giovanni Righi, que el próximo ciclo económico,
este next,
ciclo que se habla, cual Norteamérica trata de enfrentar,
America tries to confront the leadership of China and India.
Pregunta Pérez su visión, ¿cómo lo ve?
Bueno, yo, a ver,
let's see, how do you see it? Well, me from a multilateral aspect, I think it's perfect. That India and Russia establish economic and commercial relations. So in this way they can confront the hegemony of the U.S.
sobre todo el auge de China. Y por lo tanto me parece en este punto bien.
And then for,
ahora,
therefore I think it's fine.
Soy un partidario acérrimo del desarme.
Well, I really strive for disarmament. So I think that any type of a purchase of weapons is not adequate, because to confront the U.S., we don't need to arm ourselves. Because what we're doing is we're just increasing the arms race.
Del derrumbe de la Unión Soviética.
This was one of the motives why they failed.
Las estanterías de los comercios vacías.
I mean, why have so much weapons if we don't have all of the merchandise for the people?
Con un presidente muy nacionalista que tiene un conflicto abierto con Pakistán.
And of course, let's not forget that India has an open war with Pakistan.
Perdón, ahora me sale de Cachemira.
Sorry, Kashmir.
And
it's also a nuclear country. So the acquisition of missiles is a threat, is always a threat, because it will always represent a threat for the other countries in the region, especially for Pakistan and China, because the relationship with China and India have always been tense, and the border conflict has made this even worse. So I think that in this sense, I have to criticize it, because the expenditure of weapons has never helped to establish cooperation and peace relationships. So that's my point of view. Let me ask Miguel.
Disenso, Miguel, difiere Pérez Ortega, bien la multilateralidad, digo bien, No así la cooperación armamentística para hacer frente a Estados Unidos, porque no es necesario y amenaza a otros países de la región como Pakistán. Miguel.
Es muy importante la unión de bloques de países, y sobre todo lo que está haciendo Asia Central,
Asia is doing,
la Federación Rusa,
and the Russian Federation,
India,
along with India,
con Irán,
and their agreement
con,
with Iran,
China,
and with China themselves, who,
are,
who have
a new route
to, and China that has this new Silk Route. But also, Europe should know
that
the main
en Siria, en Irán,
that the main
en
weapons
Libia,
development,
los responsables, aparte
the responsibles,
de Norteamérica,
apart from the U.S.,
de la OTAN, las
have been the main, the members of NATO,
de todo el planeta, los que propicia una
those who foster
planeta, los que
the war,
en el
those
año
who
2010,
wrote records
donde llevaron más naciones
in 2010,
a participar en asunto
and they
bélico.
Took more
lo hace
countries.
España, lo hace la Moncloa, quien agazapadamente se mete en diferentes conflictos y los circunda con esto Francia y otros países
all
de la
these
OTAN,
countries
en
are
terrible alianza que han hecho con los comandos unificados en toda esta área, la AFRICOM, las bases militares en Afganistán, en la
all of these military bases
China
that are present, that's why China and India, that are nuclear, just
España,
like my Spanish friend says, they also,
de las armas, ¿no?
They also show off their weapons, because obviously we're not in a model
de
of elements
de paz,
of peace. Unfortunately, the world is now seeing the geopolitical earthquake of war. And the countries must be in blocks now
at
time, especially in this area of Asia, because this allows to put a break to the expansion
de Europa,
of Europe,
de España, de Francia,
of Spain,
de Norteamérica,
of North America,
del Reino Unido, quienes con su fórmula
who with their
pues han tratado
evil
de
formulas
la del sur.
Have tried
esto
to
esto
drown the economies
sur,
of the South.
Sur,
this is the defense of the South against the North.
Yeah. Gracias, Miguel. Bueno,
thank
es una
you, Miguel.
Que no sé si
this strategic alliance
a lo militar, hay una cuestión muy
that is not only in the military.
Le pregunto a Pere.
I would like to ask my guest when we spoke about this point
of
the commercial agreements that have been sealed.
Eso también podría significar un golpe a
this,
la hegemonía
this could also
en el caso
be
de comercial.
A hit. For the U.S.
Well,
I think it's perfect that they pay themselves with their own currency and that we don't use always the dollar as the only currency available. Of course, this is a low blow for the U.S. and obviously for the U.S. that is always favored because all of the transactions are done in dollars. Well, in the case of Europe, we do it with euros. And this also is a hit for the U.S. We cannot put everything in the same sack to say that Europe participates through NATO. But there are strong discrepancies between European countries with what Donald Trump is saying. There is not unanimity with the European countries because some of them are worried, like France and Germany, and also Spain, that the U.S. has broken international agreements of the nuclear agreements and that are basically are to threaten Russia. But this does not mean that the policy of blocks is something negative of the international policies, because this is to create confronted blocks. Instead of having blocks, we should have no tensions, and we should have commercial agreements, cooperation agreements among countries, like the one of India and Russia.
India tiene buenos acuerdos.
But we have to think that India has also good cooperation agreements with the U.S.
Emergentes, como es el caso de India, o Brasil,
like in the case
o China,
of India or China,
la propia Rusia, que no es una potencia emergente porque siempre ha sido una potencia, ya es bueno que haya multilateralidad.
It's great that there's multilateralism and there's cooperation.
We have to impede
any blocks like NATO, because we know that it's dominated by the U.S. and it's also useful to dominate Europe. So, therefore, we have to find the rupture of blocks. And if the military aspects, it will not be good for cooperation, for universal peace. You say that we should make peace agreements.
A su juicio, si queremos tener paz, ¿no?
If we want to be in peace and stability in this threatened world from so many aspects. But one of the blocks is that led by the U.S. and it's operating in that direction. Well, like my colleague said, the OTAN, the NATO block that is led by the U.S., but internally, internally of NATO, there was, because there was a distension, because
el artículo 5 de la OTAN que dice que hay que correr, debíamos ponernos al lado de Estados Unidos en la guerra.
The U.S. wanted NATO to be by their side. However, that was not applicable because France did not want to use it, did not want to apply Chapter 7, and also because there is an autonomy of Europe in NATO. So this means that they want to distance themselves from the U.S. And it's not to confront Russia. So I think that here we have to play to the multilateralism and cooperation among countries.
Un gran reto por delante. Crear bloques,
we must create blocks. If we create blocks of military purpose, this does not facilitate world peace. But on the contrary, there was a risk of nuclear war. Now, what we should not do is to fall again in the same trap. As the U.S., the USSR and U.S. did, of creating two antagonic, two confronted blocks that divided the world in two great blocks. So therefore, I think we should walk in another sense. There are several studies and experiences that say that it's the disarmament, the best route to create trust between countries. So, buying more weapons, it's the wrong path.
Bloques antagónicos, hay que jugar a la multilateralidad, cooperación entre estados, y allí especialmente tienen la responsabilidad las potencias. Le pregunto a Miguel,
let me ask Miguel
para continuar este debate,
to continue this debate, if all the parties are winning.
Miguel, fíjate,
and please,
Alfredo Jalife. Para Modi, el foro de
Vladivostok
es susceptible de construir la plataforma del noreste asiático y del lejano oriente,
is a way
hacia la Unión Euroasiática a través de la región Indo-Pacífico libre e incluyente.
And to have a free trade zone eventually.
Que leíamos, Alfredo Jalife, ello no ha de complacer mucho ni al secretario
and this
de Estado
obviously
Unidos,
does not make Mike Pompeo
de Defensa, Mark Esper.
Or Mike Esper very happy. I just
en el debate,
quote
opinión,
this.
Miguel.
What is your opinion, Miguel? Well, this recent summit that was held in Russia, where there is an open door for Asia-Pacific, this obviously doesn't please the U.S.
como los que vemos en los BRIC o lo que Venezuela que intenta impulsar en Sudamérica.
There are these, there's always blocks. But if we see on the other side, we could also say that there are huge blocks on the other side if we must be in blocks.
Que circundan alrededor de la OTAN, pero la alianza indudablemente,
but the alliance undoubtedly must be
todo este término de relaciones
of this relationship of economic exchange, commerce, business, technological,
como la recién reunión que se
as the recent meeting that's being held
with Putin en la Federación Rusa,
in the Russian Federation.
Que habla de un ánimo,
and obviously this speaks of a different sense, because
mundo
the world is overheated right now.
Fatiga,
we're in fatigue.
Muy pronunciada. El mundo camina al
precipicio, the world is walking to a precipice,
y el sacrificio que se ha hecho,
and the sacrifice that has been done towards many countries have taken us to limits that were unthought of. North America, I don't think, is much aware of the sacrifice that they impose
on
thousands of countries of the South, where there's the major concentration of people. So all of any type of exchange, any leadership, to understand that there's a multipolar world, we will support it. And not forget the terrible results
that the
globe is living of war and violence.
Algunos lo que ha imperado es la agenda norteamericana y la circundización y
con
de otros países.
Isn't going in this sense.
Ha sido muy lamentable y de un gran show guerrerista el cual han esparcido.
And there's a war show that is spreading all around the world. That is not controlled. The world, the South, must tell this military model that this is enough.
Por otros caminos,
that we have to take another path,
de una manera muy significativa,
that the ambience has been stricken,
está,
and now more than ever, humanity is committed.
Ahora,
together.
Miguel, te pregunto,
Miguel, let me ask you,
¿valoras como neutral la postura
do you think that
India
India's position is neutral?
Estados Unidos frente a Rusia y China?
India tiene un
well, India
espíritu de estado de
has
desarrollo indudablemente
a development
que
and state spirit
como su crecimiento de 9.75
obviously reflected in their production
and
their advance.
Nobel en física, en química,
they've got several Nobel prizes in math and physics and chemistry, and this makes India
de desarrollo muy grande.
This makes India to have large developments, and of course, they
de en las
they have intention to even grow bigger. With this, all this, I want to tell you that India has their own life.
1,250 millones de habitantes con
with
un
over 1,000 billion
bastante
people.
Marcado, indudablemente,
and they have
a
development
del escenario internacional, del escenario global. Y tiene autonomía
and
para
have ejercer
en el área con sus vecinos, con
to,
Irán, con
to
China,
work in their, in their neighborhood
más alejado,
with
pero,
Iran, with China,
en la misma área, el mismo paralelo con la Federación Rusa,
and with the Russian Federation.
La India tiene un crecimiento
India
acentuado,
has a growth that is very clear. They have differences with the U.S. like they have it with China.
De sus empresas. Pero también India no deja de
but India
ejercer, su
still has their,
their
sovereignty
militar,
in the military area. 12 million militaries.
Nucleares, es decir, con una política
they have
de desarrollo muy clara en
a
la región
clear
de la
development policy in the military aspect. And to end
China
up, what about China?
Hombre, China es, sin duda,
well, China, without a doubt, will be the biggest power in a couple of hours, in a couple of years. They will, of course, they will beat and defeat the U.S.
Por lo tanto,
in
es
growth.
El enemigo.
So therefore, obviously, is the enemy of the U.S. That's why the U.S.
su potencial militar hacia el sudeste asiático instala bases.
And they install bases that surround China, and we should criticize this because China is not in a wars race.
Su potencial militar.
And they have not invested in their military force.
Ni en el tema nuclear, ni en el tema balístico, sino que simplemente lo que ha hecho es reforzar mucho su armada.
What they've done is to reinforce their current, capacity.
Porque se siente amenazada en
and of course they do this because
en la afluencia
they feel threatened.
Del comercio mundial y de la llegada de recursos a China, porque ese potencial
económico
necesita
that military, that economic capacity,
islas artificiales, precisamente para que la afluencia de recursos hacia China no se vea interrumpida ni mucho menos
so
por alguna crisis
just to defend their commercial aspects.
Y que no es descartable.
And of course, that is something that is perfectly possible.
Por ejemplo, voy a poner un ejemplo muy claro.
For example,
el asedio que Estados Unidos hizo a Corea del Norte.
The siege that the U.S. did on North Korea.
De Corea del Norte estaba desestabilizar a China, porque China es el principal.
Let's not forget that this might be the main intention. And if Korea was stabilized, they did not have the same leverage. So China will be a great power. They have played it very well. It will be an economic, industrial, commercial, technological. But they have not gone on the military aspect. So of course, their military expenditure has grown.
La segunda potencia en gasto militar mundial aún está muy lejos.
However, they are far, very far, of the five biggest military powers.
No gastan más que la mitad de lo que gasta Estados Unidos militarmente. Por lo tanto, China no es una amenaza.
China is not a threat from that point of view, from the military point of view.
En el ámbito industrial, en investigación,
and they play their cards in the industrial point of view. And from that sense, we can say that China is very skillful and we must support it. And I think it's fine that they have commercial relationships. For now, there has not been a military front. There is not a military bloc between Russia, China, India. And hopefully that will never exist. I think China will never do it because they will not fall in that trap.
Para que su economía continúe
because they know they need
la presencia de China en África subsahariana.
They need everybody's support to keep on growing.
Cada vez es más potente, más fuerte, y por lo tanto va a jugar con esa baza.
And therefore, they will play with that.
De lo contrario,
the U.S., on the contrary, they want to isolate,
bloquear,
they want to block China,
y entorpecer su economía con continuos,
with continuous.
Bueno, ahora está el tema de los aranceles.
Well, now there's the tax, but
in
the military aspects also they have
tiene bases militares que rodean
military bases that surround all of the China Seas.
Intenta ese camino, pero
and of course they try that route. However, the intelligence of China is that they've never fallen into that trap to try to get into an arms race. But they do it on a commercial front.
Fluidas con todos los países.
And they have good relationship with every country.
Muchísimas gracias, Pere, y también el agradecimiento
thank you very much, Pere, and to Miguel from Venezuela.
Hasta pronto.
Allí see you soon.
Bueno, independientemente de hacia dónde se
well, independently of what the results of this relationships might be, it's undoubtable that these are two key actors.
Rusia, India.
Russia
potente
and India.
Y desafiante polo de
powerful
poder mundial. Ambas naciones son estratégicas en el mapa mundial. Por ejemplo,
pivotal,
Rusia,
con 17 million square kilometers,
es el país más grande del norte. Ocupa toda Asia del norte y 40% del territorio europeo.
It occupies all of Asia and 40% of Europe,
lo cual le otorga condición de transcontinental o euroasiático.
Es a Euro with
Pacífico y Ártico y con un total de 16 países.
Its limits with the Ocean Pacific and with the Pacific Ocean and the Arctic. And a total of 16 countries.
O aún sin explotar, lo mismo que tiene
it has 144 million inhabitants and is huge in resources.
It has petroleum, gas, forest,
the fourth part of, of fresh water, not in form of ice. It has a tradition in art, science, and technology. It is among the economies that grow the best. It has nuclear arms and an important defensive development. It is part of the Security Council, G20, BRICS, Shanghai Cooperation. It's the leader of the tandem against the multipolarism and for sovereignty. In the case of India,
300.000 kilómetros cuadrados es el séptimo más extenso del planeta.
It's the seventh biggest country in the world, and it has 3,300 square kilometers.
Tiene más de 1,300
and after China, it has it is the second largest country in people.
Su riqueza es cultural y comercial y grandes imperios.
The richest is the cultural, it's multilingual.
Alberga una flora y fauna diversas.
It has lots of
tiene también una de las
flora and fauna. It has one of the biggest economies in the world. And of the largest growth, however, they do have malnutrition.
Tiene relevante arsenal nuclear.
They have
nuclear
weapons. They're part of the BRICS, G20, and the Organization of Growth of Shanghai. Let's ask the vision
of our next guest.
Should we, what we're going to analyze is, should we keep on doing blocks?
Pérez reconoció que hay actores que son completamente antagónicos y así lo demuestran en su accionar. Y bueno, vamos a detenernos en un punto muy particular.
We're going to stop the political policy of Trump. We're back in our critical mood. China, Russia, it's a partnership that threatens the U.S. Should we see it like this? What is the foreign policy of Putin that has made a hard actor in the political world? Several analysts coincide in three moments of the foreign policy ever since Putin arrived to the policy. Between 2000-2007, they were getting closer to the West. And up until the conflict in Crimea, there was a policy of defense of their interests. Ever since the conflict in Crimea, it has become a pivotal actor. And then there was a decree signed on December 1st of 2016 when they called the new doctrine of foreign policy of Russia. This one replaced the previous document of 2003. The main principles are to guarantee integrity, sovereignty, and at the same time to create the conditions to create competitiveness and to make Russia one of the leaders in the world and recover their weight in guaranteeing democracy. It is also said that Russia says that it's negative for the creation of NATO, along with the increase of the military investment in that zone. As another objective, they want to counteract the destabilization of the world and work with the European Union and stabilize Africa and the Middle East. It is said that the creation of a defense system against the U.S. is a threat
Respecto a América Latina,
in regards to Latin America, they say that their objective is to make their ties even stronger. Let's keep on. Let's start with Sandino Asturias. He is an analyst of Guatemala. So nice to hear him again. Sandino, we come from a very interesting debate in the first part on something that has to do with the relationship of Russia and India. And this aspect is about weapons. And if this marks that India will be independent from the U.S., what is your opinion? Well, in the first place, I think that we have to globally locate what's going on in the international relations. I think that Russia has positioned themselves as one of the main powers that has the better comprehension of the international geopolitics. And what they're doing is they're counteracting everything that the U.S. does. I think they have been very intelligent when they have reestablished the world dynamics. And there we have the examples of with India, with Turkey, the relations with Latin America, with Europe. And if we see it in a world context where the president of the U.S. is confronted with almost every country in the world, we see how Russia has become a reference of peace in a very historical concept. And in this context, I think it's important the Pacific coexistence, peaceful. To accept the differences of what's going on is the most important thing, is to understand the rules. And in this context, the relationship with India has been marked. And I think that it's important to see and admire the profound changes that the foreign affairs policy has had. And now they're seeking to have world peace, and they don't interfere that could compromise their sovereignty. And on the contrary, they just want to attain world peace. So in this context, I think it's important to see the international relationships. And I think that the aggressive policy of the U.S. has put former countries that were not so friends, I think that they've been able to find allies of Russia that before were not so close. But thanks to this policy, this foreign policy that is so good, they've been able to attain allies and gain links with countries that historically were not close to the Russian policy. And do you think that the Indian policy is neutral? Well, India has a context that comes from the relationship of Pakistan with the U.S., and that is their main conflict. That is why the relationship of India with Russia has to do with the relationship of Pakistan and the U.S., and all of these conflicts that have happened, U.S. has been always behind it. So therefore,
más serio en el cual
therefore
permanentemente en conflicto,
the fact that India is permanently in conflict needs a counterpart, military and strategic. In this case, it's been Russia that has given this counterpart and this in the problem with Pakistan. And on the other hand, the U.S. has been very aggressive with India. So, as long as it's this historical relations, what they do is to consolidate exchange, commerce, weapons,
el conflicto fronterizo que tiene la India con Pakistán. Entonces hay que verlo
so,
en una globalidad.
I think we have to see this as an integrity. But we have to recognize that India has been gaining space. This is the space that the U.S. is losing with their aggression. In the case of Japan, do you think it's the same game?
Sí, o sea,
well, yes, I think that definitely that what is revealed in their policies against China and this tariff war and even the conflict that they have with the European Union, what is generating is a new world geopolitics where Russia is playing a positive role and that's gaining the spaces that the U.S. loses. Thank you, Sandino, for this contact. A big hug, Lucia. We're running out of time. We hope that next time we can have him personally. Let's go to our conclusions. It's a conflictive world with the clash of very diverse and important actors. We must advance to multilateralism, not anymore having antagonist blocks. No longer should we have the U.S. leading a world that isolates the rest. And on the other hand, we have Russia that, of course, they produce weapons and they sell them to several countries. But at the same time, they are calling for peace and they respect the sovereignty of countries. And they have not displayed these weapons to go against anybody. India has a historical relationship with Russia that they don't want to lose, not even with the hardest threats that the U.S. has made. And, well, there's an ambiguity there that we must keep on analyzing. There are more things that we must analyze in this aspect, but we will do it in next programs. Thank you very much for being with us.